Tantor Audio, a division of recorded books, presents A Forgotten Hero, Folke Bernadotte, the Swedish humanitarian who rescued 30,000 people from the Nazis, by Shelley Emling. Narrated by Julian Elfer. We weren't brought into this world to be happy, but to make others happy. Folke Bernadotte. Prologue. How could this happen? Manya Moskovich's life began to unravel on the first Friday in September of 1939. Up until then, the chief discomforts the precocious 13-year-old faced in her small town in central Poland were physical. Scrapes from running barefoot through fields of prickly vegetation, or a stomach upset by eating too many green apples. For her, there was no harbinger of the sinister events to come. The anti-Semitism already endemic in Central Europe at the time, even when she and her family moved to a larger city nearer the German border in 1938. She had noticed a few signs popped up around town urging Poles to boycott the hundreds of Jewish businesses scattered throughout Zosnowicz's streets. But Manya, a spindly girl with a round face, pretty dark eyes, and frizzy black hair, was rarely personally troubled by such intolerance. On that late summer morning in September, however, word spread that the Germans had invaded her country. By the end of the weekend, the Nazi armed forces, the Wehrmacht, had rolled into town with their machine guns and shredded the only Polish soldier left in the vicinity to defend it. Overnight, Manya's world, and that of her parents and two brothers, was turned upside down. The wolf was on her doorstep. Anti-Semitism now wore a uniform and carried a weapon. Surely, she remembers thinking to herself, the world will not allow this miscarriage of justice to continue. Surely, the world powers will step in and stop the madman behind it all. Surely, someone will do something. They did not. In Zosnowicz, the anti-Semitic slurs and slights turned into outright terrorization. Jewish shop owners were jailed and their businesses handed over to German or Polish citizens. Authorities confiscated the valuables of Jewish families, right down to their bicycles and clocks, and distributed ration cards that allotted them only a miserly few staples. Jews were ordered to identify themselves by wearing white armbands, which gave the Germans license to stop them in the streets and search for contraband. The local synagogue was burned to the ground while its congregation was forced to watch. German soldiers and civilians filmed themselves gleefully tormenting Jewish men in the streets, beating them or making them perform for the rolling cameras like dancing monkeys. From that day on, there was not a peaceful moment. Any insignificant thing meant life or death, Manya remembered some 70 years later. Our entire life depended on the attitude of the SS or the Gestapo or their degree of drunkenness. One evening in particular stands out in her memory. A German had moved into an apartment in their building and demanded flower boxes for his balcony, like those that adorned Manya's home. He barged through their front door, drunk and brandishing a pistol, along with the building's superintendent. Manya, her brothers, and their mother cowered in separate corners of the room while the belligerent man chased their father around the kitchen table, shouting obscenities and waving the gun. Only when her father promised to deliver the flower boxes the next morning did the man agree to leave. Surviving each day was a minor miracle. Neighbors vanished during the night, never to be seen or heard from again. A mandatory curfew led to indiscriminate arrests, often with the same outcome. The uncertainty was almost unbearable. Each evening they would huddle in their parlor, waiting and praying until each member of the family returned from the day's errands. Only after everyone was safe under one roof for the night would they heave a sigh of relief as an uneasy calm settled over the household. Day after day it continued. By the end of 1940, Jews from the surrounding towns and villages had been corralled into Zosnowicz, forced into ghettos where they could be controlled more easily. Thousands were deported daily, but thousands of others obtained jobs in local manufacturing shops dedicated to the war effort. In March 1941, Manya found such work, which afforded her a precious Sonderkarte, or proof of employment that had the power to prevent deportation. She worked as a seamstress, sewing pockets on uniforms for Nazi soldiers and the mustard brown shirt sported by the Hitler Youth. She labored doggedly and tried not to attract any attention, for fear she'd be sent away. And for many months, the routine continued without interruption. But one evening, 2 years later, as her shift was ending, her luck ran out. SS officers surrounded the building and the entire staff was rounded up for deportation. She was immediately hustled off to a deportation center. Her parents were allowed to bring a single suitcase to her at the facility but were forbidden from speaking to her. Manya stared into the faces of her parents as her younger brother clawed at the fence between them. They seemed to age 20 years in an instant. I assume each one of us had the same thought. Will we ever see each other again? She recalled decades later. As it turned out, that was the last time I saw my parents and my two brothers. Days later, the rest of her family was sent off to the notorious Auschwitz concentrationslager, where they were immediately segregated. Manya's father and older brother were placed in one line, while her mother and younger brother were placed in the other. Her father refused to be separated from his wife, so he and her brother crossed over to join her. It was an easy line to cut. It was destined for the gas chamber. Manya was 17 and alone for the first time in her life. She was sent to a new privately run camp in Gleiwitz that produced soot or carbon black for the rubber tires needed for the Nazi death machines rolling across Europe. The facilities were new and clean, and she was assigned an office job. Others, not so lucky, toiled in dungeon-like chambers full of furnaces, where they breathed in noxious fumes as jet-black dust coated their clothes and any exposed parts of their perspiring bodies and faces. Before long, the SS took over the camp and it became an Auschwitz outpost. Her jolly, her word, German boss was replaced by stern SS officers and unforgiving female German overseers known as Kapos. The girls' heads were shaved, they were stripped of their clothes, and paraded into a room full of officers where every inch of their bodies was prodded and manhandled, every orifice probed. For a modest young girl, it was the ultimate humiliation. I cannot forget that feeling, she recalled later. I don't think I got undressed to take a shower in front of my mother, and here, naked, we had to go in front of the Nazis to have our arms tattooed. And of course, from that day on, we were not called by our names, but by our numbers. But believe me, they took away much more than our names. Henceforth, Manya was known as 79357. One evening in January 1945, as the Russian army ground down Adolf Hitler's army in the east, there was a commotion in the camp. They were being evacuated, Manya learned from her fellow prisoners. Those left behind, the whispers insinuated, were to be exterminated, put through the Schornstein, chimneys, in the vernacular of the SS officers, rather than left alive as evidence of the Nazi atrocities. Her close friend Lola lay nearly unconscious from fever in the infirmary, and Manya was faced with a choice: leave her friend to the fates or bring her on what was sure to be a perilous journey. She chose the latter. Wearing the distinctive striped dresses and carrying only a single blanket for protection from the January cold, Manya and her fellow prisoners made their way to the railroad station and waited for transport to another camp. After a night shivering in a barn, they were herded onto open-top rail cars normally used to transport coal for what they were told was a short journey. But the trip was nearly 600 kilometers. They were headed northwest to the Ravensbrück camp near Berlin. The cars were packed. To prevent Lola from being crushed, Manya positioned her friend in a corner and clung to the side rails to brace herself against the mass of bodies pressing on her with each lurch of the car. For 10 days, the train rocked back and forth over narrow gauge tracks through the bleak, war-scarred countryside. South at first, toward Czechoslovakia, in a desperate quest for a route unscathed by Allied bombs, then finally north again. Blankets soaked by falling and melting snow were their sole source of water. Their only nourishment was bread that sympathetic civilians hurled into the cars from overpasses. Czechs who came to the stations to offer sustenance to the starving women were pushed away and even fired at by Nazi guards. One woman, a nurse who dared to raise her head above the side rails to ask a guard for water, was summarily shot and left to fall onto the tracks between the cars. Lola, by some miracle, survived the journey. Manya, Lola, and the others could have had no way of knowing this, but the end of their nightmare was not far off. The most horrific war the world had ever seen was drawing to a close. By late 1944, the Allied vice had been tightening on the Third Reich, and the disintegration of the Nazi state was all but inevitable. In the West, Germany's desperate counteroffensive against the Allies in Belgium's Ardennes forest ended in complete failure, and in the East, the Red Army captured East Prussia and reached the Oder River, less than 50 miles from Berlin. Soon, the Third Reich consisted only of Germany proper, a few territories in Central Europe, Northern Italy, Denmark, Norway, and parts of Holland. The Nazi Air Force, the Luftwaffe, was a skeleton of an air fleet, and the Allies ruled Europe's skies, showering thousands of tons of bombs on Germany every day. The landscape through which the women were ferried looked almost lunar. As Allied powers gained the upper hand, the world outside Germany began to breathe easier. But inside Germany, it was a different story. Adolf Hitler ignored or shrugged off the obvious, hurling orders in an increasingly erratic and delusional state. Backed into a corner, a dog is going to bite. And Hitler was nothing if not backed into a corner. Driven by an insane determination, he shunned every opportunity to surrender to whichever of the Allies might have received him most sympathetically. It mattered not that his cities were being reduced to rubble or that chaos reigned over his precious but shrinking Reich. The Führer's hatred of the Jews only intensified. And he was not alone. Raging anti-Semitism remained rampant among his heel-clicking party officials and among a wide strata of the population at large. Hitler declared that Germany would fight to the finish until the very last man fell. Even by the horrifying standards set by years of Nazi genocide, the final phase of the war was to be more deadly, more vicious, more gruesome. Like no other event, the Second World War has been dissected and analyzed by historians in every manner conceivable. Often overlooked, however, is the concentrated period of lethal violence in the closing round of the war. Of the millions who perished in the concentration camps, around 30% died in the final 5 months of the war. Most succumbed to the consequences of SS criminal neglect, starvation, exposure, and disease. Others were shot, hanged, or otherwise killed by the SS camp staff and guards. Rumors had been circulating in the fall of 1944, the same whispers that caused such a commotion in Mania's camp before her hellish rail journey. Hitler planned to liquidate all prisoners still languishing in the concentration camps. He preferred to destroy the camps and their internees instead of surrendering such indelible evidence of atrocity to the Allies. Hitler confirmed the rumors at a secret cabinet meeting. "I shall conduct this final struggle with all my might and by all available means. I therefore issue this order. Empowered to fulfill the final extermination shall be SS national leader Heinrich Himmler. Following the course of the war in different areas or on special order on a predetermined day, all prisoners in jails, hard labor camps, and concentration camps will be put to death, regardless of whether they are prisoners on remand, convicts, or in preventive arrest, as well as hostages from every country." Hanging in the balance were the lives of Mania, Lawler, and more than 750,000 other prisoners snared by the Nazi death trap over the previous 5 years, who somehow managed to keep breathing until the early days of 1945. Schutzstaffel Reichsführer Heinrich Himmler, who had created the concentration camp system, wasted no time implementing the Führer's wishes. While his own mental and physical state teetered on the brink, Himmler ordered the complete evacuation of all camps in the east. According to several testimonies, he also issued an ominous warning to the camp commanders. "The Führer holds you personally responsible for making sure that not a single prisoner from the concentration camps falls alive into the hands of the enemy." Among the prisoners still alive were more than 200,000 women, a quarter of whom were held 56 miles north of Berlin in Ravensbrück, the largest and most notorious of Nazi camps for women. Opened in 1939, Ravensbrück adjoined the idyllic Lake Schwed and was surrounded by pine trees. Nazi leaders believed that the cleansing of German blood should begin close to nature. The German communist Margarete Buber-Neumann, who came to the camp after spending time in a Russian gulag, said of her first impressions of Ravensbrück's perversely beautiful setting, "This is a concentration camp?" But over the 6 years of its existence, around 130,000 women passed through its gates to be beaten, gassed, starved, executed, poisoned, or worked to death. Estimates of the final death toll range from about 30,000 to 90,000. The real figure probably lies somewhere in between, but so few SS documents on the camp survived that no one will ever know for sure. The most serious overcrowding occurred after the evacuation of Auschwitz in January 1945, when an unknown but significant number of Jewish women arrived at Ravensbrück. By then, many of the other camps had been liberated, but Ravensbrück remained fully operational under Nazi control. During the final weeks of the war, more than 6,000 women were gassed at Ravensbrück, thousands of others were shot or starved. From 1939 to 1941, the Nazis had toyed with a variety of techniques to accomplish Hitler's goal of eradicating the Jews. Camp commandants experimented with various killing methods and conferred with each other on their successes and failures, as if they were researchers trying to cure cancer. The capacity to murder hundreds of people per hour at a single camp was no small undertaking. It was a skill that took years to hone and perfect. At first, men, women, and children were simply shot at the edge of vast pits so that their bodies would drop into what became mass graves. In 1941, SS General Erich von dem Bach-Zelewski conveyed to Himmler, by then the second most powerful man in Germany, his worry that the method may traumatize his men. As Himmler recorded in his diary, "And he said to me, 'Reichsführer, these men are finished for the rest of their lives. What kind of followers are we producing here? Either neurotics or brutes?'" At the time, Himmler couldn't have cared less. The Nazis then experimented with carbon monoxide as a killing agent, but they eventually decided that the most effective and efficient method, developed for Auschwitz, was to use the same pesticide applied to prisoners' clothing to kill lice. The disinfectant, sold under the trade name of Cyclon B, was in plentiful supply and readily available. Once exposed to properly heated air, the crystals exuded a lethal gas. The so-called final solution was soon up and running efficiently across the empire. Filled with self-delusion and growing increasingly desperate as the Allied armies began advancing into Germany proper, Hitler decided to emulate the defense his armies had encountered in Russia. He issued a number of orders, culminating in the call for total destruction of anything and everything that could be of possible use to the Allies as they advanced. In March 1945, Hitler signed an order to destroy everything of value so that nothing fell into the hands of the Allies. The official command was issued under the heading Demolitions on Reich Territory, but entered into history as the Nero Decree, after the Roman Emperor who is believed to have deliberately set Rome ablaze in 64 AD. That decree was a death sentence for hundreds of thousands of Jews and other Europeans still in Nazi custody. In cases where there was no time for mass extermination, prisoners were ordered to take to the road, often in bitter winter weather, so that the camp would be empty when the Allied and Soviet forces turned up. It was one of the war's saddest chapters. Evacuating prisoners were told nothing about what was happening or where they were going. Many believed they were being taken out to a far-off field to be shot. Instead, they were made to walk for hours in inhumane conditions. Dressed in nothing but rags and wearing wooden shoes, they staggered in the snow and freezing mud. The SS organized them into rows, usually five across, and in large columns with guards on all sides. The prisoners were forced to keep pace, often at a run. For those already ill, weak, and hungry, it would be impossible. Hours passed. They kept marching. More hours. More marching. Many quickly succumbed to their frailty and could no longer keep up. They fell behind and were summarily shot by SS guards stationed in the rear. At least 250,000 former prisoners, more than one-fourth of them Jews, died on these death marches between January 1945 and May 1945, when Germany finally surrendered. Those who weren't murdered outright died of cold, hunger, and sickness. Today, their graves line the roads surrounding the places where the Nazis built their camps. One of the largest marches began on January 17, 1945, 2 months before the Nero Decree, when about 60,000 prisoners from Auschwitz-Birkenau were forced to parade 40 miles under guard, mostly on foot, to Wodzislaw Szloski, where they were loaded like cattle onto trucks and trains and taken to other camps. At least 15,000 prisoners died in the process. Elie Wiesel, winner of the 1986 Nobel Peace Prize, recalled in his 1958 memoir, Night, how he and his father were forced to march from Monowitz-Buna, a sub-camp of Auschwitz, to Buchenwald. Pitch darkness, every now and then an explosion in the night. They had orders to fire on any who could not keep up. Their fingers on the triggers, they did not deprive themselves of this pleasure, he wrote. If one of us had stopped for a second, a sharp shot finished off another filthy son of a bitch. Near me, men were collapsing in the dirty snow. Shots. It was one of those forced evacuations that led Manya Moskowitz and her fellow prisoners from the camp in Gleiwitz to the gates of Ravensbrück in January 1945. The camp was even worse than what they had imagined during the 10-day train journey. Emaciated, ghost-like individuals wandered around in a daze. Dead bodies lay everywhere. When they first arrived, they were ushered, terrified, into showers. By now, anyone who had spent any time in the Nazi camps feared the showers. This time, the fear was unwarranted. After a delousing with noxious powder, they retired to the barracks and slept prone for the first time in nearly 2 weeks. At Ravensbrück, rising for morning roll call, known as Appell, meant climbing over the corpses of fellow prisoners who had died during the night. The Kapo's shrill whistle marked the start of an interminable daily ritual. Guards calling out the prisoners' numbers waited, often in vain, for faint acknowledgement from the zombie-like figures standing before them. Many of the women fainted from exhaustion as the process ground to a halt and restarted when the numbers didn't add up. Custodians wheeled carts full of corpses, bodies held together only by skin, passed the women to the crematorium. Often an arm or a leg would fall off, only to be retrieved and tossed back into the cart like a piece of produce. I said to myself, no, I'm not going to end up like that. Many times in camp you gave up. You just didn't care how it will end. You just wanted it to end, Mundy recalled later. This cart with the corpses, it doesn't get out of my mind. That's when I said, I'm not going to end up like this. A few months later, Manya was moved to Rechlin, a smaller sub-camp of Ravensbrück nearby, where the conditions were not much better. Then in April 1945, during roll call one morning, a dozen or so women were asked by the Kapo to step forward. By then, the shrieking air raid sirens and roar of Allied bombers were near constant. The women had no inkling what was going on outside the gates, though, and being singled out at camp remained a dangerous proposition. Manya stood with her peers, terrified about what fate might have in store for her that morning. They were marched to the front gate where a white truck with red crosses painted on its sides and roof was parked and idling. The tailgate was lowered and the ragtag group of women was told to climb aboard. Weak and emaciated, few had energy enough to raise their feet and struggle inside. One of the couples placed a wooden crate to serve as a step and ushered the women toward the bed of the vehicle. Manya was certain she was hallucinating or dreaming. Inside, the utter disbelief continued. The women were handed packages from the Cooperative for American Remittances to Europe, CARE, bearing labels indicating that they came courtesy of the Canadian government. Inside were powdered milk, cocoa, sardines, and crackers. The ravenous women tore into the packages and gorged on the rations indiscriminately, shoving everything they could into their mouths. Many of them threw up the rations almost as quickly as they consumed them. After years in the camps, their bodies were unaccustomed to anything approaching real nourishment. The truck bounced west at first toward Hamburg, over shell-pocked roads and past caravans of war refugees, pushing their few belongings in makeshift carts, and then north into occupied Denmark. At Copenhagen, they were loaded onto barges for the crossing to Malmö in Sweden, where the grim caravan, by then the truck had been joined by others bearing the same markings, was met by a reception of waiting clergy, rabbis, and other local dignitaries. Manya and her cohorts, their hair cropped short and matted, their eyes sunken into their skulls, and their skeletal bodies covered in filthy striped dresses tied at the waist with rope, emerged from the trucks to the sounds of a marching band belting out a celebratory ditty. Manya was in a daze. She felt, she said later, like she was hovering on the edge of the scene while not being part of it, like she was witnessing everything through a sheer curtain. Was their long nightmare finally over? Were they really free? They were. That night and in the coming days, the women were given fresh clothes, real soap, and proper showers. They slept in beds with paper sheets, those who did manage to sleep anyway. Many of them, including Manya, found themselves staring out the windows of their guest houses just to be certain they were not still in the camps and that it was not all just a dream. They were truly the lucky ones. Though she never met him in person, Manya later came to learn the name of the man who orchestrated her escape from Ravensbrück. The dashing Swedish diplomat who dared to breach Hitler's inner circle during the waning days of the Second World War, for the sole purpose of saving thousands of strangers the rest of the world had appeared willing to write off. That man's name was Count Folke Bernadotte. Chapter 1. Setting the Stage. Manya had grown up 1,000 miles away, but she soon fell in love with Sweden. There she experienced a kindness of spirit she never forgot. On May the 8th, 1945, Victory in Europe Day, well-dressed men and women poured out from their homes waving Swedish flags. Meandering through the clean streets and verdant parks, Manya couldn't get enough of the beauty all around her. Wearing the first clean clothes she'd had in years, she soaked up her surroundings, ready to start a new life. The country that brought Manya back from the brink of death was the same place where the ancestors of her saviour, Folke Bernadotte, had risen to acclaim. But the Sweden of the early 19th century was nothing like the Sweden of the 1940s. To better understand Folke Bernadotte's incredible act of humanity, it's helpful to see where he came from. Far from the egalitarian paradise of tidy stoops, good government, and flush Nordic cheeks that it was to become, the Stockholm of the early 1800s was little more than a bit player on the European stage, a stagnant city surrounded by slums with a dwindling population, rampant alcoholism, abysmal public health, and widespread unemployment. Upper-class visitors from other European countries described Sweden as a whole as a poor and backwater place made up mostly of nondescript towns and villages. All cities cycled through periods of boom and bust, but Stockholm's rise and fall was particularly precipitous. Founded in the 13th century, it grew to be a major European power in the 17th century when it forcefully took control of huge swathes of the Baltic region upon which Europe was reliant for such staples as grain, iron ore, timber, copper, and furs. The population grew exponentially during this period, and by the turn of the 17th century, Stockholm had become the centre of a vast Swedish empire. Swedes called this period Stormaktstiden, or the era of great power. The empire extended well into Poland and Russia, as well as a colony on the Delaware River in North America, around what is now Philadelphia. The plague put an end to that in short order, wiping out a third of the population in 1710. The shell of a country that remained was decimated by the Great Northern War, a series of battles with its Scandinavian neighbours. Routed by the Russians in 1709, the brilliant but irascible Swedish king, Karl XII, and his troops fled south into the Ottoman Empire, where they remained, trapped in exile for 5 years. He returned home too late to salvage his empire, and the spoils were divided among the allied powers of Russia, Saxony-Poland, and Denmark-Norway. The 1750s marked the beginning of a century of decline for Sweden. By the early 1800s, much of Stockholm's population of about 70,000 was crowded around the royal palace in what is now known as the Old Town, an island in the main waterway connecting the freshwater Lake Mälaren with the Baltic Sea. Today it is a charming labyrinth of cobbled streets and winding alleyways lined with cafes, restaurants, artist studios, and purveyors of tourist trinkets. Then it was largely a fetid slum, its unpaved streets dotted with taverns full of drunk patrons coughing themselves to death from tuberculosis, and alleys where prostitutes with bared breasts plied their bodies from windows and doorways. Other women lived in crowded, often windowless rooms with floors of stamped dirt. There they sat at spinning wheels all day after sending their preteen children out to collect human excrement door to door in cans that they would deliver across the water of Mälaren to the saltpeter refinery, where gunpowder was made. Even for men, employment was catch-as-catch-can. Soldiers in the royal barracks often moonlighted as cobblers or other tradesmen to supplement their meagre salaries, and those lucky enough to find work during the relatively abundant summer months were often jobless and destitute again when winter's dark days returned. Consumption, fevers, stroke, and edema contributed to one of the highest mortality rates in Europe. Between 1750 and 1850, there were only 4 years in which Stockholm saw more births than deaths. Marriage rates plunged, and out-of-wedlock births, or bastardy in the charming parlance of later economists, skyrocketed. Death was always just around the corner. Graveyards were said to be so overloaded that skulls and bones poked out from beneath mounds of fresh dirt. If malnourishment, the average Stockholm resident subsisted largely on a diet of bread, potatoes and oats, or drink, brännvin, a brandy made from potatoes or grain, was a fixture of nearly every meal, even for children, didn't do one in, then the extras that made their way into the diet would have for certain. One female silver polisher complained in 1800 that a loaf of bread she had purchased from a local bakery had a whole rat at its core, from which an evil taste arose. A shoemaker arriving in Stockholm around this time concluded that the Stockholm life had produced such feelings of unpleasantness and cheerlessness that I decided to travel to another country, no matter which one. He moved to St. Petersburg before eventually settling in Paris. All this set the stage for the founding of the House of Bernadotte, a royal dynasty that continues to this day. By the first decade of the 19th century, much of Europe was mired in war and revolution. Sweden's King Carl XIII's two children had died in infancy, and his adopted son and successor, Prince Carl August, also passed away suddenly in 1810. The country was in turmoil with no heir to lead it. This drove Sweden's ruling parliament, the Riksdag, to look outside the country for a fresh face to fortify the teetering monarchy. They found it in the countenance of Jean-Baptiste Jules Bernadotte, one of Napoleon's top generals and one of Folke Bernadotte's most distinguished and dashing ancestors. Jean-Baptiste's spectacular rise in the ranks may partly be due to his marriage to Désirée Clary, Napoleon's first love. Despite the famously fickle French leader's marriage in 1798 to the widow Joséphine de Beauharnais, Napoleon continued to care about and look after Clary's well-being for the rest of his life. Jean-Baptiste's military prowess also caught the eye of Napoleon, who eventually made him a Marshal of France, one of the highest honours of the era. Why the Swedes would put an ambitious, middle-aged French marshal, the son of a lawyer, in line for the throne had much to do with the existing royal family's own desperation. They had lost Finland, an integral part of Sweden for seven centuries, to Russia in 1807. After such a humiliating defeat, a bold action was called for. The hope was that Jean-Baptiste, a talented soldier who had shown much prowess on the battlefield, would help them take back Finland as well as steady the wobbling monarchy itself. And so Bernadotte came to Sweden and assumed the title of Crown Prince under the name Carl Johan, Carl after the king who had been on the throne, and Johan as the Swedish version of Jean. Very soon, though, he made it clear to the ruling nobles that he had no intention of trying to get Finland back. In his opinion, it would be military suicide. Instead, he set his sights on a prize he was certain he could win: Norway. Still a determined and courageous commander, Carl Johan put enormous military pressure on Denmark, an ally of France and Napoleon that ruled over Norway at the time, and succeeded in preventing the territory from gaining its independence and instead forced it to join in a union with Sweden through the Treaty of Kiel in 1814. The campaign to prevent Norway's secession was to be the last war Sweden ever fought. Carl Johan and Désirée had only one son, Oscar I, who inherited the throne after the death of his father in 1844. But a protracted period of bad health cast a pall, and Oscar's reign lasted a mere 15 years until he died in 1859. His eldest son, who succeeded him as Carl XV, was handsome and charming, the very embodiment of a king. In time, though, his power was greatly diminished as the Riksdag assumed more authority. Carl left one child, Louisa Josefina Eugenia, by his marriage to Louisa, the daughter of Prince Frederick of the Netherlands, and was succeeded by his brother Oscar II in 1872. Oscar II, Folke Bernadotte's grandfather, reigned over a revival in Sweden, referred to as the Great Transformation. The backward agricultural nation of the previous century was evolving into a modern industrial economy that laid the groundwork for the welfare state that would follow in the 20th century. The country's abundant natural resources had much to do with the economic growth of the era. There were timber booms in both the 1850s and 1870s, and when the forests were exhausted, the Swedes figured out a way to turn wood pulp into paper and revolutionized the global publishing industry. Iron ore exports to Europe ratcheted up, as did local steel production. Ericsson started making telephones in 1876, and by the 1890s, Stockholm was one of the world's great telecommunications capitals. Gasworks, sewage, and water mains were introduced to the city, and streets were paved. Stockholm cleaned up nicely and was like a whole new city. Oscar II ruled with the best intentions as he navigated the deteriorating relations between Norway and Sweden, which share a 1,000-mile border. But under his rule, the two sides' interests diverged beyond the point of reconciliation. Discontent simmered and eventually boiled over, with Norway believing that Sweden treated it as a junior partner. Calls for autonomy grew louder. In the spring of 1905, the Norwegian government voted for independence. In a public referendum, over 99% of Norwegian voters favoured dissolution, and Sweden had little choice but to negotiate a formal end to the union. On October 26, 1905, Oscar II officially renounced his claim to the Norwegian throne, and Sweden finally recognised Norway as an independent constitutional monarchy. When not delicately handling the Norwegians, Oscar II concentrated his efforts on artistic ventures, the remnants of which are still enjoyed today. He established the world's first open-air museum near his summer residence in Christiania, now Oslo, in 1881, and he commissioned a new opera house for the Royal Swedish Opera in the 1890s. He also was a prolific author, writing the memoirs of King Carl XII along with his own. He was so self-assured when it came to the arts that he once told celebrated Norwegian playwright Henrik Ibsen at a dinner held in Ibsen's honour that his famous Ghosts was not a good play and should never have been written. After a moment of stunned silence, Ibsen replied that writing it was preordained. "Your Majesty, I had to write Ghosts." In 1907, as he lay dying, Oscar II asked that the theatres not be closed in the event of his death, as was tradition. The country respected his wishes. Oscar II passed away in Stockholm, after which the eldest of Oscar's four sons and Folke's father became King Gustav V. Like his father, Gustav V proved to be a capable and enlightened leader, and is considered one of the more outstanding monarchs in 1,000 years of more or less sustained royal Swedish distinction. In a break with tradition going back nearly 700 years, Gustav V cancelled the grand ceremonies associated with a formal coronation. He also opted against wearing a crown, a custom that continues to this day. Gustav V championed a long list of social reforms, among them an 8-hour workday, employer-provided accident insurance, and government-subsidized low-income housing. Most notably, he confirmed the deep-seated change in Swedish society by helping enact universal and equal suffrage, including for women, in 1919. He was the type of monarch who enjoyed strolling the streets, stopping to talk with surprised passers-by along the way, a practice that earned him the reputation of being the people's royalty. In 1881, he married Victoria of Baden. Gustav V was a devoted player and a grand patron of tennis, a game he picked up in 1878 during a trip to England, years before he became king. After returning to Sweden, he founded the country's first tennis club. When given the option, he'd always take chasing balls on a casual court over listening to opera in a fancy theatre. He played tennis privately and competitively, usually under the name Mr. G or another pseudonym, well into his 90s. From his uncle, Folke Bernadotte inherited a burning sense of fair play and honour. From his parents, the overarching lesson must surely have been that in the face of true love, everything else must be cast aside. Indeed, the story of Folke's parents' courtship can only be described as a fairy tale, even though it meant that Folke would never ascend to the throne in Stockholm. Born on November 15, 1859, Folke's father, Prince Oscar Carl August, was the second son of the future King Oscar II and Queen Sophia of Sweden and Norway. Like his father, Prince Oscar was a dutiful servant and joined the navy at an early age. But his future took a left turn after he met the woman who would become Folke's mother, Ebba Munk, a dazzling young lady-in-waiting to the crown Princess Victoria. Oscar's stated desire to marry Munk set off an immediate scandal. The Swedish constitution prohibited princes of the royal house from marrying non-royals, even if they were from a noble family. Oscar begged to be allowed to renounce.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.